Ladies and gentlemen, what the world has been waiting for, what the world needs now, the one, the only, amazing, original, Jenny Blaze. Often imitated, but never duplicated, there's Jenny.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you all to the amazing original Johnny Blaze show. It's always great to be here as I blaze right in with my karate kit. Let's have a blazing hot fun time. A lawyer sat alone at the bar. Suddenly a sexy woman appeared and sat next to him. For $200, I'll do anything you want me to. Okay, the lawyer replied, you can start with my office and then clean the bathroom and then do my laundry. No woman is happy until she gets four animals in her life, a tiger in her bed, a mink in her closet, a jaguar in her garage, and a jackass to pay for it all. A man walks into a bar and notices a tiny man playing the piano. He asks the bartender, where did you find that little guy? The bartender gives the man a magic beer bottle. Here, rub this bottle and make a wish. The man asks for $1 million. Suddenly, 1 million ducks appear in the bar. I didn't ask for $1 million, the man said. Yeah, well, I didn't ask for a 12-inch pianist either, the bartender replied. How do computer programmers make money? Half of them write viruses, the other half write the antivirus software. I was given three pieces of valuable advice as a young man. Always be on time and continue to work on my math skills. Always borrow money from a pessimist. They never expect you to pay them back in the first place. We do have a blazing hot fun show with a special guest. He is a multi-talented award-winning singer, songwriter, and an all-around entertainer. So please give a big warm welcome and say hello to the one and only Richard Lynch. Hello, Richard Lynch. Welcome to the amazing Richard.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Great to meet you, sir.
It's great to meet you too, Richard. Yeah. Looking sharp there, Richard.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome. Give me a rundown, Richard, of the Richard Lynch Show. Tell me, how did you get started in entertainment and where are you from?
Well, I guess you might say I was born into country music. By that, my dad was an incredible entertainer, singer. So I grew up in a household where country music was a way of life. From my earliest recollection, I can remember getting up and dad would be sitting at the kitchen table drinking coffee, and that old round top radio there in the kitchen in the old farmhouse would always be playing traditional country music. So that's just something I was born into and fell in love with at an early age.
That's fantastic. So it's in the family, it sounds like, Richard.
Yeah, you know, I learned an awful lot from my dad. By him being in the industry and in the music business, at a young age, gave me a lot of opportunities. He was pretty well established in around the tri-state area, the Ohio, Kentucky, Indiana area. I live in a little old town called Waynesville, but I grew up about 10 miles south of here, a little town called Lebanon, Ohio. And dad was quite established in those, you know, from the 50s and 60s on. And, you know, I got away with a lot of things by being Woody's son that I wouldn't have been able to had I not had a dad in the music business, you know. Like I was 15, 16 years old playing in the bars, and I don't think I'd have got away with that if I hadn't been my dad's son.
I see. What does your dad do exactly? You know, you say he was in the music industry. What exactly did he do in the business?
Well, he was a guitar player, singer. He grew up in a time where, you know, in the 50s where, you know, he was so influenced by people like, Ernest Tubb and Hank Williams and everybody from that era. And, you know, I remember as a kid listening to those old records that Dad had, the 78s and all those cool things as a kid that, you know, you don't necessarily hear about anymore, but that's just something that I, you know, I cherish as a memory, all those wonderful artists that he had.
And so, okay, those are his. What about yourself? Who are your inspirations? And also, did your dad teach you as far as music and entertaining and performing? Did he teach you anything about, you know, singing or songwriting or anything that you?
Well, I guess you might say my earliest influence as a child probably still is my biggest influence. A guy named Conway Twitty really just absolutely blew me away. Whenever you watched Conway and he would put every fiber of his being into his delivery, into his delivery for his music, and he just put so much passion in, and his stage presence was just amazing. I just fell in love with Conway at a very young age. And if I had to give a close runner-up, a guy named Keith Whitley would be a real close runner-up for a big influence on me.
Who was that, Pete? I didn't hear the last name. What was it, Pete?
Keith Whitley.
Oh, Pete Quigley. Okay.
Yes.
I see. Well, Conway Twitty, I definitely heard. Oh, yeah, he's had some great hits out there. He really is really something, Conway Twitty. He puts a lot of power and passion in what he's doing. Yeah.
Right. That's just somebody that always, even as a kid, all the way to now, if I see something on Conway today, and he's been gone since the 90s, but, you know, if I see a television, you know, something that has to do with Keith from Conway from back in the day, I always stop and listen and watch the man because he just completely impressed me all those years.
You remember the song, It's Only Make Believe? That was a top hit of his. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I used to do that song. I mean, I still do occasionally, but I love that song.
Yeah, that was so popular, so entertaining, so much fun, what he did. Sure, that's fantastic.
Absolutely. Well, tell me.
Yeah, talk to me and tell me about a typical day as a singer and songwriter.
Well,
what's a typical day as a singer and songwriter, Richard?
Well, I live on a farm and I grew up on a farm, so I'm pretty lucky that I can still do that. You know, I get a lot of inspiration as I write music from different things. Somebody will say something that really hits home with me, and I've learned that I gotta stop whatever I'm doing and write that inspiration down, because a lot of times that idea for a song will go away just about as fast as it comes. So I definitely stop and drop now whatever I'm doing and write that inspiration down. You know, Richard Lynch, you know, I'm a guy that loves and appreciates, you know, a hard day's work. I grew up on a farm, and I'm fortunate enough to live on one now. And if you live on a farm, it's not an easy thing to do. But I was raised to where you welcome hard work, and you welcome and be appreciative of a hard day's work. And I think my music kind of reflects, you know, towards you know, real traditional values.
What kind of music? Now, what kind of music do you go for? Is it country? Is it pop? Is it rock? Is it folk? Is it classic? Is it jazz? You know, there's anything. Is your favorite country? Is that what your favorite is?
Well, that's not only my favorite, but that's the only thing I do. I want real traditional country music. I don't want to be confused with. A lot of people hear country music and they tend to blur the lines, as far as I'm concerned, with the modern stuff. I tend to be more of a traditional sounding artist. And by traditional, I mean you got steel guitar and fiddle and harmony and a storyline. And I try to put emotion in whatever music I'm writing and singing. But a lot of times emotion gets left out of some of the music being recorded today. I definitely believe that emotion should be an importance in the music these days.
What is there about country that really appeals to you, really excites you? I mean, obviously, that's your thing. That's what you really enjoy. That's what you do.
Well, like I say, I was raised around it. Something about the simplistic genius. I'll just put it that way. If somebody can sing a song, and I've had people tell me, Richard, you wrote a song, and it's almost as if you wrote that song about me. And I hear that often. Well, to me, if you can reach someone in a simple song that affects a person or they associate that music with their life, I find that really rewarding. People come sometimes where I'm playing music and they'll tell me, well, we knew that you were going to be at a certain place, so we took a couple days vacation to make sure we could come see you here. But it's not about me, it's about the music. They connect with the traditional sound that they're accustomed to and not necessarily getting nowadays.
So you like to put a lot of feeling into your music. That's what it sounds like. And you do you prefer like upbeat, fast songs or slow songs or ballads? And what is there any particular type of songs when you write your music and you perform? Do you just like them all, or you like certain ones? You like cover songs or original songs, or?
Well, everything I write is original, but I write upbeat tempo tunes. I write, you know, slow, heartfelt ballads. I write funny song with lyrics. I write little things situations that occur to me from time to time. So there's no rhyme or reason as to what I write, but I've learned to kind of be kind of versatile. And whatever happens, put it down with some music and some paper and roll the dice and let it get out there.
And how do you come up with your inspiration to write these songs, these original songs? Does it come with the music or lyrics first, or is there any particular formula you have for writing these great songs that you do?
Well, I get asked that a lot. And to define it or explain how that inspiration works, I don't know if I can even explain that, but I will tell you this. I used to be, you know, kind of apprehensive or not necessarily confident in my music. Mm-hmm. And but the more I've done it, the more I realize that I'm getting pretty good at it. And so just go with your gut. And if there's something out there that I feel needs to be said, I don't hesitate. I put it down on paper and pen and put a little melody to it and let her go. it don't always work out sometimes, you know, like it should, but I'm always honest about my music.
Well, that's great. That's really great. It sounds like it's something, it's a passion. It's not something you force yourself to do. It's something you truly love with your mind, body, heart, and soul. You love it all. So that's fantastic. Tell me about any of your performances now. Tell me about the venues that you've had, any favorite venues and your tours that you have done, and what is there about that you like?
Well, I've played a lot of venues over the years. My first paid gig was in June of 1978, and so that's going back a day or two. And I've played it from Texas to Maine and from, as far east as the East Coast and all over I've never been any further west than playing in Colorado, but I've never been on the West Coast. But there's so many wonderful venues out there that I've played. When people ask me what's my favorite place to play, you know, they expect to hear Texas, and there's a lot of great people down there, don't get me wrong. But the most warm, receptive place, and I don't know why, is Michigan. For some reason or other, whenever we play in Michigan, there are so many wonderful fans that come out and support what we're doing. And I can say I can't tell you a reason why, but it seems like those folks just go above and beyond to come out and support our music.
What was that?
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, excuse me. I wanted to say, do you have any outstanding like memories of any of such a great performance over there in Michigan? Anything great that it was thoroughly exciting and it was unexpected in the way that when the people reacted to you You say they react really well. Is there any particular favorite memory you have of performing over there?
Well, yeah. There's a place up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. A dear friend of ours, Joe Blanchard, you might call him an ambassador of traditional country music. He knows so many of the stars that's been around for many, many years. And he had us come up and do a performance at his home there. And in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, it's very remote. Not a whole lot of big names, get to that. Well, there are some, but a lot of folks come up there in Michigan, and the fact that they're not so overwhelmed every day by a star, they come out and support those artists that are willing to drive and go up north up there, because I think that's probably one of the reasons we have so much success in Michigan, because we've made a connection with those folks that are from the Upper Peninsula and northern part of Michigan. They don't necessarily get a whole bunch of mainstream artists up there. So if there's somebody out there that they want to go see, and they're willing to drive up that far, they'll definitely support them. So I really have some great memories up there.
That's fantastic. Have you ever had a performance now? Well, okay, a nice performances now. Would you say your crowd? Can you give me an idea of the kind of crowd? How many people would you say are in it? Would you say it's a gigantic crowd, or is it a smaller crowd? And which do you prefer, the larger or the smaller?
Well, I love a big crowd by all means, but sometimes a smaller 150, 250 pound, 250 person or 250 person show is pretty intimate. And I can, I'm the kind of guy that wants to hang around and shake hands with everybody who wants to hang around. And if I could meet with everybody, I would certainly love to. I would stay as late as it is. So a smaller crowd is a whole lot easier to be, that intimate feeling with. I enjoy, I've done shows with 6, 8, 10, 12,000 people in the audience, but I can't really get that personal connection with that big of a show. So there's a lot of excitement about the bigger show, don't get me wrong, but the intimacy of a smaller show seems to be a whole lot more personable.
I see. So probably the smaller shows you're at, but you're able to do some meet and greets. You probably do meet and greets in performances, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I can say, as long as anybody wants to stay, I'll be more than happy to stay with them, shake their hand, hug their neck, sign whatever they want to sign, and just get to know them. That's something I learned from my dad as a youngster, treat people well. And, when you make that personal connection with somebody, whether you really know them or not, they think you do. And therefore they're going to support you. They're going to promote you. They're going to come spend their money with you. I definitely love people anyhow. And to be able to make that connection with folks is a pretty personal thing for me.
I see. Have you ever had any, let's say in your performances, you can probably get audience participation in your shows, right?
Oh, absolutely. I get a lot of satisfaction out of people wanting to, sing along with us, especially my own music, to see somebody, sing along and be a part of the show. That's pretty special.
And how do you get audience? Give me an example of your audience participation, a typical when you do a show.
Well, if we're playing a rowdy nightclub or whatever, we got a couple of beer drinking, honky talking, good time and songs. That little song called "She's Got Me Drinking Again" comes to mind, and they will definitely have a hoot 'em up, have a great time when that song comes up, and they'll be up on a stage and just having a blast.
So you're able to get them to, how do you get them to participate? Do you start clapping with them? Do you, are there certain techniques that you use to get them to participate?
Well, I'm not sure I have the answer to that. Just let it go. I mean, I'm the kind of guy that if you come to one of my shows, I'm not boring. I'm going to make sure everybody's enjoying themselves. So, and especially if they've had a cocktail or two, they might loosen up a little more. So, and be wanting to be part of the show.
I see. Well, what if you find that they are bored, how do you go about energizing them and turning them around and getting them excited?
Well, I typically just kind of let the music speak for itself. You know, I have played shows where, you know, they're not necessarily excited, for lack of better words. But, you know, I just keep working them a little bit. And next thing you know, the music kind of speaks for itself. And people ultimately want to have a good time. And so if they can have a connection with a song, I'll try to find that song, whether it's one of my own songs or a cover song that they're familiar with. But I don't think I've ever played anywhere where, you know, it wasn't received quite well.
I see. You ever had a performance where you tried your best and everything, you had great intentions, but for some reason, things didn't quite work out the way you wanted to. And if that's so, then how did you handle something like that?
Well, it has happened. I think everybody that's played music, especially as long as I have, you know, you've been in situations where, you know, you wish you'd had a little better crowd response, or if you'd had a, you know, sometimes even equipment cannot necessarily, you know, I'll give you an example. We played a great big old place down in South Texas a few years ago, and our system just really wasn't big enough to, you know, to really do a great delivery for the sound. You know, in other words, the venue should have provided a sound system bigger than what we had. So sometimes, you know, you get in a situation you just don't know about, and equipment sometimes can be a problem. But most of our equipment shows we are quite adequate. But occasionally you'll get into something that, you know, we should have had a little bigger system. But, you know, that's kind of really the venue's fault, really, if you put us in a situation like that.
So the equipment wasn't right. So how were you able to get around it? If the equipment wasn't right, how were you able to handle it and still make it successful, the show?
Well, we did the show fine, but it could have been a little more louder. It could have had a little more volume. It could have had a little more substance. But if you're playing a big old area and you know, our PA system is pretty amazing, but everything has its limitations. And that's one thing that really kind of I remember that, you know, that PA system we brought down there was, you know, it could have been about twice as big as what we had. The show went over and we went over fine, but it would have been nicer if we'd had a bigger, larger PA system at that particular show.
I see. Okay. And how do you handle now in entertainment? Of course, I didn't like, but especially in entertainment, there's a lot of rejection. How do you handle rejection yourself? The things haven't always gone smooth. Haven't gone always gone smoothly for you, I'm sure.
Let me ask you, say that again. How do I handle what now?
How do you handle rejection? You know, rejection in life is, you know, especially in entertainment, there's a lot of rejection. So if you've had it, how have you been able to handle it? And also, have you ever had any anxiety before shows? And if so, how did you deal with that?
Well, you know, really the only rejection, we've been in Nashville and so forth, and there's been different things that, you know, we've submitted our music to be, you know, published here, published there. But, you know, some things, you know, just can't be helped. I don't necessarily believe rejection is, I don't really take rejection personal. I just keep going and doing what I do. And ultimately it's worked out for me. If I worried about what everybody thought, you know, I wouldn't, you know, at some point you tend to lose confidence. So I think rejection can be a healthy situation. You learn from something. Ultimately, a rejection, I've got a couple in my life, but it's always worked out to where I've benefited from it because of that rejection and made myself better.
So you're not letting that stop you. You're turning your scars into stars, and you're still working with it and moving right along. You're not letting that affect you. That's easy to get discouraged.
Absolutely. You know, we all get so many days on this old earth, and we just kind of learn from things. And you know, I tell young people that listen, you know, if I talk to people that, you know, they ask me, you know, what can I give them advice for? And I just say, surround yourself with good people that believe in you. And, you know, that was some advice that my dad gave me years ago. Just surround yourself with people that believe in you, and don't be afraid to take you know, criticism and grow from it. And I think that's pretty good advice.
That makes a lot of sense. You ever had any performance anxiety before your performances, like anticipation where you get kind of a little nervous or stressed? And if so, how do you deal with that, Richard?
Well, it's been a long time. There was back in the early days when I was, you know, getting started and not necessarily confident. You know, you got to build your confidence over a matter of time. I would get a little nervous, especially if we were playing a bigger show or whatever, and I wanted everything to be just perfect. And not necessarily learn how to, you know, just kind of let things happen. But the older I've gotten, it takes an awful lot to get me nervous nowadays. I just smile, have fun, and go out and enjoy what I'm doing.
I see. Well, that makes sense. That's great. That's important. You can't have fun at what you're doing because you're in the wrong business, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it shows with your audience too. If you're enjoying yourself, you know, ultimately the crowd will see that and respond accordingly. And for the most part, they'll enjoy themselves also.
It's called karma. What goes around comes around. Positive karma. You're giving out positive vibes. So that usually
I'll buy that.
People pick up on that and they applaud, they smile, they applaud, and they have a great time. And that's what you want them to do.
Absolutely. Of course.
There you go. Have you had any music competitions? And if you did you win any awards at all, Richard?
Years ago, we would do things, you know, they call it Battle of the Bands, different things, you know, around. I remember way back in the 1980s, I was involved in a Battle of the Bands around Dayton, Ohio, and we would always do well. Sometimes we'd win, sometimes we wouldn't. But, you know, the truth of the matter is, I play music as much as 250, 300 nights a year. From the 80s all the way up into early 2000s. And so, you know, back then there were so many more opportunities, you know, nightclubs and honky-tonks and festivals and fairs and so forth that really are gone nowadays. A lot of nightclubs are gone that we used to play years ago. So, you know, I was always busy, busy, busy with the music. So sometimes I would have to be coaxed or asked to be a part of a Battle of the Band or something because we was always working so much.
What kind of work did you, before you got into entertainment and music, what type of work did you do before that?
Well, I was born on a farm, and so I was raised, you know, baling hay and taking care of horses and cattle and, wow, and the farm and doing the farming life. And my dad was a pretty established builder, and so I kind of followed those footsteps for many years, you know, building new barns and new homes and just kind of, I did a lot of things my dad did, and I don't know why, I loved his lifestyle, I guess, and I followed right into his steps.
Well, it sounds like your dad set a good example for you, and he passed that on, all those experiences to you. You're a better person, sir, for it. That's right, Richard.
Yes, sir.
I see. Well, there's a lot of things that are going on. Yeah, what's a typical day? Let me ask you, what's a typical day as a singer and songwriter, you know, give me a rundown, give me an idea of what's a typical day as a singer and songwriter in your life.
Well, a typical day here for me, you know, is just enjoying life. I guess I could sit down and write a song just to be writing one, but I like to write from inspiration. I like to be able to have that little special connection. You know, in the morning I get up and I'll go out and feed the horses and you know, a lot of my farming stuff is done for the year, you know, waiting on spring for anything activity as far as, you know, farming chores that have to get done. So I have a lot of free time now that I don't necessarily have when it's warm weather. For a typical day for me is just appreciation of the fact that I've got a farm that I live on and a wife that supports me and lots of folks out there interested in my music. And that's just a pretty old typical day for me. I'm an appreciative kind of guy.
That's great. How did you and your wife meet, by the way?
Well, we met many, many years ago. we've been together about 17 years, but we were friends, you know, 35 years ago, you know, and she went through a divorce about the same time I did. And it's just funny how life has a way of pointing you in the right direction. Eventually, I guess you might say, but she's my biggest fan. She does everything in the world as far as promotions, and hardest working gal you're ever going to want to meet. And, you know, she's, I made a deal with her years ago. I said, you know, we'll do this music thing, and wherever it takes us, it takes us. But if you don't go, I don't go. So if I'm playing music somewhere, you're not going to see me out there without her. I'll put it that way.
Well, it sounds like you two met some, I don't know exactly where you've been for 17 years, exactly where you met, but you obviously hit it off, and she helps you and you help her. So it works out.
Absolutely. Years ago, she would come out where I was playing music, and we had been friends for all those years. And it's funny how, you know, we were friends many, many years before we ever became, you know, a couple. So there was that mutual respect and appreciation that we had that you don't necessarily always have. So I just found it, you know, her being my friend all those years ago, and then now she's my wife, but she's still my best friend.
That's a happy, successful marriage, it sounds like. What does she do for work? It's like she promotes you, part of it, but.
Yeah, she is successful. She runs a three-store tax franchise. She's a whole lot smarter. Why she married me is beyond me. I don't know. But she's very intelligent, has a really big work ethic, and she does and she helps me on the farm. She's constantly doing things with the music that I write and record. She's responsible for so many aspects of that, you know, the putting together the new CDs, putting together the radio and TV, you know, connections, putting together all the different legal aspects of the music business, dealing with ASCAP and BMI and all those other names. She's absolutely the brains and the backbone of Richard Lynch, I'll put it that way.
Well, you're very fortunate to have met her, and start off as a friend and blossom to a successful, happy relationship and romance and marriage. So that it works out for both.
Absolutely.
People. That's fantastic.
Absolutely.
That's very good, Richard. Have you ever appeared on television? Have you done any radio spots or been on television? And if you have, talk to me about that.
Oh, yeah. I've done lots of television stuff. I think our music right now is currently being played in about 110 countries around the world. I've been on Fox Network, been RFD Television Network, a lot of hometown networks, you know, down in Texas and Georgia and Tennessee and Kentucky, and a lot of TV stations in Ohio. The music thing has been good to me. I've had an awful lot of opportunities.
What do you attribute that success to, seeing being able to have so many performances on TV and radio? What do you attribute that to? What do you think that feel that that's the reason why? I mean, it's great that it happened, but what do you think the reason is behind that worked out so well in your favor? You've been successful.
Well, if I had to point to one thing, I think being genuine and remaining true to what I've always loved, and that's the traditional sound of music. I think people are really hungry. If you were a country fan in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, you know, you always had that more traditional sound in modern country music. Well, today you're wondering where your music has gone. And so I think the fact that I've kept my music traditional, people appreciate that, and they connect with me, and they know what they're going to get when they come to a Richard Lynch show. They're going to get that traditional sound. It's brand new music. It's my own music, but it has a reminiscent sound of something you would have heard maybe in the 80s or 90s. You know, people like people compare my music sometimes to, you know, oh, like Alan Jackson or George Strait or you know, Waylon Jennings or somewhere along that type of music. But even though, like I say, it's my own, but I kind of get compared to those artists from time to time. And so if you're not getting a whole lot of mainstream traditional country nowadays, and they hear the name Richard Lynch, they know if they want to be entertained by traditional music, that's what they're going to get, traditional sound.
What do you think about artists like Garth Brooks, Glenn Campbell, Dolly Parton? I mean, there's quite a few other people. The late John Denver, you know, those people were great in country.
Absolutely. All those artists you just named influenced me.
Yeah.
They influenced me. All of those guys and gals did at some point in my career. And I would definitely call them traditional sounding country artists. I just have the utmost respect for them. You know, those are the kind of artists that touched me then and touch me now. So I definitely feel a respect for those artists you just named, for sure.
Well, yeah, they're great. They really are. How about things like the Grand Ole Opry and also American Music, Country Music Awards? What's your opinion and feeling about that, about those events that go on in the country field?
Well, I love the Grand Ole Opry, especially what it represents. I've never been fortunate enough to grace the Grand Ole Opry stage, but I think that's something that if you're a country artist, that's kind of a goal in life at some point. May happen, may not, but I have nothing but the most wonderful thoughts of the Grand Ole Opry. As far as, you know, the music goes, if I'm fortunate enough to continue writing and continue recording, you know, maybe someday that opportunity will present itself. And I'll say this, if I don't get there, it won't be because I didn't try. It's because I've certainly been putting a lot of good music out there and paying my dues, you might say.
It certainly sounds like it. You've done quite a bit. Yeah, you have done quite a bit, that's for sure. You get around and you
yes, sir.
You take pride in what you do, and that's fantastic. It really is.
Thank you.
So some other things I wanted to. Have you ever had any? Okay, I know you've had a lot of successful, great performances, but is there a performance that you felt like was the worst? And if that was so, then how were you able to overcome that and make sure that didn't happen again? I mean, you never know in any performance that you're doing.
Well, when I was in high school, one memory that probably will never go away, I was asked to be on a variety show, and I was excited to do it, but I used to have laryngitis quite a bit until I had my tonsils removed right in high school. So I was having a sore throat issue, but I told him I would sing anyhow. So I got up there and had a few squeaks. And every now and then I get reminded of that performance. So that's really the only thing that really sticks out in my mind that was, embarrassing, for lack of better words. But you know what? It's life. You know, sometimes I have been known to get on a stage and forget the words to a particular song every now and then. I do that every now and then. But what I've learned to do is just, you know, maybe put some of my own words to it, make them up as I go. And most people, they don't even realize I've done it. My wife always reminds me. She says, "Hey, did you make up some new lyrics to that particular song just then?" I'm like, yeah, you picked up on that, huh?
I was going to ask you about that. If you ever have either can't think of a song, you know, in the process, you all of a sudden forget about the words in a performance, or even when you're writing a song, if you've got like writer's block, if you had that happen, and if you did, you know, how do you deal with that? I was going to ask you
about. Well, it has happened, and thank goodness most people are forgiving, you know, but sometimes it just, words just escape me. If you come to one of my shows, you're never going to see the same show twice. I never I never have a set list. I kind of feed off of the crowd. And every now and then, you know, my mind will be thinking of the next song or the next couple songs that would fit the circumstances of that particular show I'm doing. So every now and then I'll be thinking of the next song or whatever I should be doing, and not necessarily doing thinking of the particular song that I'm doing at that moment. And every now and then I make a mistake and forget a few lyrics or two. But you know, fortunate enough for that, one of the guys in the band will kind of give me some help, or you know. But I usually get through and cover it up pretty good.
So you just act like it didn't happen, go right over it, and people don't even notice it. They don't notice it that much.
Yeah, pretty much. Some people notice it, but for the most part, I'm pretty well covered up pretty good.
I see. Well, you're doing your Richard Lynn thing. You're doing it, and you're changing it up. You're doing your own thing, that's for sure. Have you ever worked with any celebrities, Richard?
Oh, absolutely.
Tell me about it. Yeah.
I've been fortunate enough to work with so many of the greats. I've graced the stage, and I've been fortunate enough to record with some of my heroes. I've been in the studio with people like David Frizzell and Ronnie McDowell and Rhonda Vincent, I've worked with so many great names like T. Graham Brown and the Bellamy Brothers and David Ball, and I can go back to the 80s where we've done shows with David Allan Coe and Eddie Rabbit. And I can just, there's been so many, so many wonderful names that I've been fortunate enough to work with and grace the same stage with.
And how did you go about meeting them? And I mean, Ronnie McDowell, he was the voice of Elvis Presley. He's got that kind of a voice.
Yes.
You know,
I am very fortunate to call Ronnie my friend, my personal friend. And I don't know how much you know about Ronnie McDowell, but he is truly a genuine patriot. He did three tours of duty in Vietnam. And, so he's a big supporter of our military men and women, as I am. And we have a couple shows that we do at our farm and different places where we do shows around the country, and we'll do a show for our veterans. And Ronnie was going to be on one of our shows, and that's how I got to meet him initially. And I had written a song called Love Tattoo. And the Love Tattoo is a song that's appreciative and shows appreciation for our military men and women. It's the tattoo is not ink. The tattoo happens to be from a scar, a battle scar. That's what we're making reference to, what their love tattoo is. So I sang the song in the show, and then I was on Ronnie's show, and then I got to meet Ronnie after the show, and I said, Ronnie, I've got this song that I have recorded and written called Love Tattoo, and if you get a minute, I'm going to let you take it home with you and listen to it. Think about it, and maybe if you like it, we could get together and record it together as a duet. Well, we sent the music home with him, and almost immediately, a day or so later, he called back and said, hey, I would love to record that with you. So we got in the studio and recorded as a duet the song called Love Tattoo, and it's a tribute for all the men and women that served in our country. And so that's how me and Ronnie got acquainted. And since then, we've done several shows together. We've played New Year's Eve together a couple times. We've done multiple shows in Tennessee and Ohio and different places around the country. So he is as well known as he is and great entertainer. He's also a good person. And I'm just proud to call him one of my personal friends.
That's fantastic. Thanks for sharing that. And Eddie Rabbit, that's another one. It's another great artist. Remember that song, I Love a Rainy Day? He did quite a few.
Yes. You know, Eddie Rabbit wrote the Kentucky Rain that was originally going to be his breakthrough song, which was recorded by Elvis.
Yeah, Kentucky Rain.
So,
That's great.
So Eddie Rabbit's been, you know, a huge influence on me since back in the 70s. And, you know, he's another artist that I was fortunate enough to, you know, to do an opening act with. And the particular show with Eddie Rabbit, the first time I met Eddie, we were playing up in Dayton, Ohio, outside festival. It was 95 degrees outside. I mean, it was just super hot. And Eddie was such a class act. I'll never forget it. He got off his bus and walked straight to the stage in that really beautiful suit he had on. And you know, he had to be absolutely on fire, but he never pulled not one thing off the show. I mean, he never pulled any articles of clothing off. He kept his jacket on. He did such a wonderful job and put so much energy into it. And I thought, man, you know, he's got to be on fire. And yet he just stood there and did his performance. And I was always impressed with his level of professionality on his stage presence. I never forgot that.
That's great. What about Elvis? Did you ever meet or see any of his concerts?
Elvis Presley? No, I would have loved to see Elvis. I was 14 when Elvis passed away.
I see.
So, you know, that's somebody that, you know, as a kid, my mom had every Elvis record, every 45, every 33, everything Elvis ever had. My mother had all those records. And as a kid, I can remember, you know, grabbing them stacks of records and playing that record player as a kid for hours on hours, you know, just listening to Elvis stuff. And so Elvis was definitely a big influence on me.
That's what I figured. He probably would be. Yeah, he was on me too. I wish I could have met him. The concerts were, you know, you didn't need to have the right connections to get in. Usually when they announce the concerts are all often sold out, you need to know the right people. And then I don't want to go by myself. So between that, it just didn't, that type of thing did not happen. That wasn't meant to be. But it was something else. Exactly. He was one of a kind and unforgettable. You're never going to see anybody like Elvis Presley again. There's a lot of imitators.
To this day.
Yeah.
To this day, he still loved that. Me and my wife went and seen him, that most recent Elvis movie. And I learned a lot about Elvis's personal life that I didn't necessarily know, but that was such a great movie. We went and seen here back in the summer about Elvis's life.
We just saw this latest Elvis movie. It was phenomenal. Yeah.
Yeah. I loved it.
It was great. He did it. I think that guy won awards, the actor, I think. He won awards.
If he didn't, he should have. That was amazing. What a delivery. And then Tom Hanks played
Tom Parker. That's right.
What a great acting he did on that guy. I mean, I didn't realize, you know, how much I knew he helped Elvis in a lot of different ways in his career, but I didn't realize that he hindered him a lot of ways too. So watching the movie kind of enlightened me on a lot of things that Elvis went through that wasn't necessarily pleasant.
Well, Tom Parker was a promoter, but he took advantage of Elvis, though. You know, what manager gets 50% of the earnings? He did, and he took full advantage. And, you know, as you know, he gambled away a lot of the money that he made from Elvis, and Elvis felt like he was trapped.
Right.
And he fired him once, but he had to rehire him. He was a simple country boy. He didn't really know anybody as far as he was tough. He felt very, you know, comfortable with Tom Parker, but I feel that Tom Parker should have, you know, if he would have done something different, Elvis could have been in a movie, A Star Is Born, but Parker said no, the price wasn't high enough. So he never became a serious actor like he wanted to be. Plus, Elvis wanted to travel out of the United States. And because Tom Parker was an illegal alien, he didn't want to be found, he didn't want people to know about that. So he made sure Elvis never went out, you know, out of the United States.
There's some of them, and I didn't know any of that until I watched this movie here recently, and so I was.
And he was very sad. Oh yeah, it was very sad.
Yes.
Austin Butler did spectacular roles, and that Baz Luhrmann, he did a phenomenal job of producing, directing the movie. It was great. It was a great movie. Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, I saw Priscilla Presley in person that time. I saw her at the Thousand Oaks Civic Center, which was very interesting. I wanted to get the meet and greets, but they were all sold out. But she was very entertaining. It slides about Elvis on the horseback, and she had a ring when she got married and everything, and she was so proud of it. And the other guy, the guy by the name of Nigel Lithgow, who's the one, he is a friend of hers, and she said, well, he's my friend, and I asked him to be a host of the show, so he helped her out in that performance. She was really something, Priscilla. And she did quite a few of other things herself in her life. A lot of acting. Yeah.
Absolutely.
You have a, let me ask you, now you have a band, right? Talk to me about your band. Who they are, how did you meet them and everything, and some of the people, and what do they do, the instruments they play, and...
Well, I work with a six-piece band. The bass player has been with me the longest. We've been together almost 40 years. His name is John Haney. Lives in a little old town called Trenton, Ohio. And like I say, we've been together many, many years. I got a lead guitar player that his name is Tim Bennington. He was born and raised in Southern Ohio. He's been with me about 8 years now. The steel guitar player is Doug Goltz, and he's an Indiana boy, and he's been playing with me since 95 or 96, somewhere along that era. So I'm working on 28, 29 years now. The drummer, Chris Oliver, has been with me about a similar back in the 90s. He's an Ohio boy that's been playing with me for many years. And our most recent the most recent guy in the band is Tony Williams. He's our piano player. He played with a lot of people, you know, you'd be familiar with. He graced the stage with people like Vern Gosden and Billy Crash Cranach and a lot of those 70s and 80s artists. And he's been with me now for about 6 years or now, maybe seven. So those are the five members that play with me all over the place. And I make up the sixth one by playing acoustic guitar. Everybody sings, and you know, it's a lot of fun. We're just a big family at this point. You know, the guy's been playing with me for so long, they know what I'm going to do before I do.
How would you say you met all these people exactly? Did you make them a certain place or just different times?
Yeah, you know, people like John, we had a mutual friend the bass player, John. We're talking way back in the late 70s, early 80s, I met John, and we've been playing together ever since then. So we had John's dad and a guitar player from high school, a friend of mine's dad, worked together. And we got invited to play a little old show at a private party. That's how I was introduced to John. And by being in the music business over the years, you know, I've met the rest of the artists, you know, from out playing somewhere and being, you know, fortunate enough to go see them and whatever, made a personal connection. So, yeah, those guys have just been round, solid musicians that, you know, they just do a lot of the shows with me. You know, there is certain situations where I'll be in Texas or Florida or whatever, and some of the guys can't necessarily go. So I'm fortunate enough to where, you know, I can pick up some road musicians out of Nashville or out of Texas or whatever to do these shows that kind of come up on me from time to time. But I always give my guys the first chance to whether they can play them or not.
That's great. So it's like one big happy family, it sounds like. And I'm sure you introduced them, of course, in your performances.
Oh, every show they get introduced. And, you know, I make sure that they get, you know, all the respect that's due for them. We have a farm here, and I built a big old barn, music barn venue, and six times a year, June through October in the warm weather months, we bring a Grand Ole Opry star or a national artist here to our farm and play music with us. And, you know, my guys have been known to, you know, back up the other artists, you know, whether from the Grand Ole Opry or whatever. So they're pretty established musicians. They do a great job. So yeah, I'm proud of them.
That's fantastic. What is the name? Now, what's the name of your band?
It's just called the Richard Lynch Band. And I've made it, I learned a long time ago. I used to play with a group called Richard Lynch and the Renegade Band way back in the 80s. And after I started playing, you know, regionally and then and branched out to where we were playing not necessarily national, but a lot of different states, I realized there was probably 150 renegade bands out there. So I thought, there's no need to promote a band out there. So let's just promote Richard Lynch, and that's who just kept it at that.
I see. Well, Lynch is a common name. I once knew a guy, his last name, but he didn't do what you're doing. He was involved in entertainment. He was a producer of children's shows, and his name was John Lynch. That's a common name.
Pretty prevalent name. Yeah. I was fortunate enough to play in Ireland a couple of years ago, and Lynch is a prevalent name in Ireland, and I was told by several folks out there, hey, we're probably related. So whether we were or not, I don't know, but I got told that a lot.
I see. I had a next door neighbor too by the name of Lynch a long time ago in the old where I used to live. Her name was Joan Lynch, so there's a lot of Lynches.
There is.
There you go. Richard, let me ask you something. If you had to do anything over again in your life, in your career, I wanted to ask you one more. I did want to ask you something else. What about music videos? Do you have you done any music videos?
Oh, absolutely. We just released, or we will be releasing our sixth full-length Nashville recorded album. And so we have five that's been out there for many years now. So we have a couple of dozen actual music videos of different songs we've recorded over the years. And we're going to be working on a new video relatively soon for the release of our newest album. The newest album is called Radio Friend. And there's a song that's in that album called Radio Friend that I wrote as a tribute to a lifelong disc jockey that I've known all my life. And the song kind of sums it up by being, from me as a standpoint, from being appreciative of all these disc jockeys that I've met over the years. And so, you know, just let everybody know how much I appreciate, playing my music and getting my music out there. So that's the current title of my new album, Radio Friend.
So that's from your experience with a radio DJ, right? I got you.
Yes.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Very interesting. Richard, I just wanted to ask you, if you had to do anything over again in your life and your career, would you do anything differently?
Well, yeah, I think I would. I really didn't start recording until about 10 years ago. I'd always played live shows, 250 or as much as 300 nights a year, but I never got in the studio. And until about 10 years ago, my wife said, you know what, we need to get you in the studio and start getting these songs recorded and, kind of go that route. And if I had it to do over again, I would have been in the studio 30 years ago, doing exactly what I'm doing now. Didn't necessarily believe that I needed to those many years ago, but now looking back, I realized I would have been a whole lot further along. And, as a youngster, I used to write songs pretty often. Then I got away from that. I think if I could go back, I would have stayed writing songs the whole time, because I've only been writing now about 10 or 11 years now since I've been back into the writing aspect of the music. So I would have been in the studio sooner, and I would have stayed writing those songs the whole time rather than getting back into the writing aspect. Hmm.
So you would have done it differently. Okay. Do you have any present projects, Richard?
Do I have what now?
Do you have any present projects at all, current projects?
Yeah, we just finished writing our recording in early November. We just finished up our latest project, which we're going to release in January for the new album. But since then, I've got a couple new songs that I have written. We are putting together our 2023 tour dates as we speak now. We'll be doing a lot of, we do our shows here at our farm, and then we'll do festivals and fairs and different events around the country. We're just now getting started on getting that booked for the up and coming year. So, yeah, we have a lot of things in the making, and I'm always looking for that real good song that I can say I just wrote.
Well, you never know. You may come up with some big catchy hit song. That's very possible.
That'd be good. But I could use a big smash hit right now.
Well, yeah, your latest release, of course, is Radio Friend. That's right, your latest album.
Yes, it is. And I'm really excited about that.
That's fantastic.
You know, like I say, I've been very blessed and fortunate meeting so many disc jockeys around the country and know so many personal friends. And I just wanted to write a song that kind of shows appreciation for them.
Well, you love what you're doing. You love your craft and you like to reach out to people and you really put everything into what you're doing. That's for sure. Do you have any future dream projects that you have not done yet?
Well, you know, if I could put a dream project out there, I would like to say I recorded a song with somebody like George Strait or Alan Jackson. I've never been fortunate enough to make that happen, but that would be a dream come true if I could do something like that. You know, never say never, but those are a couple artists that would be definitely would fit in the dream package. You know, at some point that'd be wonderful. Let's say I could do something like that.
Anyway, if people want to find out more about you, Richard, how do they go about, you know, like on social media, give me the links. So if they want to find out more about you.
Well, the best way to find out about me and my music is to go to richardlynchband.com. And we're on all the social media sites, all the music sites. You can learn anything and everything you want to know about Richard Lynch, I promise you. Maybe more than you want to know. But go to richardlynchband.com and you can find out anything you want to know about me.
Any Facebook, any YouTube channels, any IMDb or any on Spotify or any of those?
Everything you just mentioned, we're on all of those wonderful channels.
Okay, great. Ladies and gentlemen, now what we want to do is this is showtime for on the Amazing Richard Johnny Blaze Show, featuring Richard Lynch. You're from all your upcoming album, Radio Friend. There's three different songs here that we'd like to bring out. I think you had one called was it Better Off? Not Worse Off, but Better Off is the first song.
Gonna be better off than I've ever been. I need to send a thank you card to him. The loving we made is gone just like the wind. I'm gonna be better off than I've ever been. When I first found out she had herself a new man, I told my buddies I don't give a damn. Been a couple of days of hanging with my drinking friends. Well, wouldn't you know it, she walked in with him. I'm gonna be better off than I've ever been. I need to send a thank you card to him. The loving we made is gone just like the wind. I'm gonna be better off than I've ever been. When I first saw them, I really didn't feel that bad. Till a few of my buddies started giving me crap. As they walked on by me, my friends started to laugh. Her newfound love was old enough to be her dad. But I'm gonna be better off than I've ever been. I need to send a thank you card to him. There'll be no more of me saying to her, yes, ma'am. I'm gonna be better off than I've ever been. I'm gonna be better off than I've ever been. She's got herself a trophy and now with him. She's smiling and laughing and holding hands again. But I'm gonna be better off than I've ever been. Yes, I'll be better off than I've ever been. Yeah.
Bravo, bravo, Richard. That's great. That's so entertaining. It's so fun. Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you much.
You're welcome. We have another song. We have another one of your songs, you know, for Radio Friend, from your upcoming album. It's called If. I don't want people to relax and enjoy, have a blazing hot fun time. If I didn't love you.
You say I didn't love you. And why were you my everything? I tried to show how much I need you, like a river needs the rain. So if I didn't want you, why would I beg you to stay? Why would I dream about you and build my world around you if I didn't love you? Looks like you need someone to blame as you make your getaway. Your mind's made up, your love has changed. My love for you still remains. Before you drive off through the night and you move on with your new life, let me ask one thing of you. Would my heart be broken too if I didn't love you?
So relaxing, so entertaining, Richard.
Thank you.
You really know how to write a song. You know how to perform it, that's for sure. We have one more.
Thank you.
Featuring in the Showtime with Richard Lynch, featuring his great, wonderful talent from Radio Friend, from his upcoming album. It's called My Special Angel. It's called She's My Angel, but it's... So relax, have a blazing hot fun time, ladies and gentlemen, with She's My Special Angel by Richard Lynch.
I wondered where she came from. I'd never seen her before. A special lady with so much love. She might be what I'm living for. She's an angel sent down to love me. God truly answered all of my prayers. So much of me, I'm no more to wonder if anyone cares. She must have been in my dreams at night, kept hidden just out of my world. For her to come my way sure tells me she is my girl. She's an angel sent down to love me. God truly answered. To tell you how thankful I am for you in my life. There's no one who could have loved me more, and no one else I want in my life. All of my prayers. My angel, she thinks so much of me. I'm no more to wonder if anyone cares. I don't have to wonder if anyone cares.
Yeah, it's great. Anyone care? Yeah, fantastic. Yes, I really enjoyed it, Richard. All of these songs. Anyway, I want to thank you so much for being such a great, blazing, and amazing, and inspirational, and fun, and entertaining guest. The time has gone by very fast, Richard. Really enjoyed it. Pardon me?
It's gone by too fast, and I want to say thank you for letting me be a part of your show. I hope we can cross paths somewhere out there again.
Well, thank you, Richard. I just want to say, as we get ready to wrap it up, but I want to say for all my fans and friends, always keep a smile on your face and a song in your heart. And until next time, happy trails and blaze out.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you would like to be a guest on an entertainment talk show, please send us an email at amazingoriginaljbshow@gmail.com. All of our episodes will appear on YouTube and Facebook and receive over 3,000 views. Don't forget to sign up for our YouTube channel, and every guest will receive a complimentary DVD of their appearance on the show. Remember, we are much better than a podcast. And now, The amazing, original Johnny Blaze has just left the building. Good night. God bless. Thank you. Merry Christmas.